Okay, so let's continue this overview of service application of robotics. Here you see two devices used for surgical robotics. On the left side, it's a commercial product. It was the RoboDoc by Integrated Surgical Systems. It was the first robot used for orthopedic surgery. Now, orthopedic surgery is very critical because it requires both precision and exertion of large forces in order to remove or cut parts from the ankle. So this is a prototypical application for robots, because robots can be very precise and can exert at the same time large forces with their tools by using motors. So this was the of course you have to design a sequence of motion for the tool carried by RoboDoc in order to perform the operation. Initially, the operation was not fully robotized. It was just part of the execution where the robot can intervene. And more in general, the trend is toward the combination of the presence of a surgeon and of robotic devices, where the surgeon lets the operation progress and makes large decisions, while accuracy and dexterity at the small scale are realized by the end effector of the robots. Here on the right-hand side, you see one of these. This is just a prototype. It was called Steady Hand System, which assists a surgeon, which specified by moving this tool, like where the hand is, the motion of a remote tool. So it specified where this tool should go, if it should press against some tissue and so on, but correct imposes some constraint on the mobility. It's like using this, what are called virtual fixtures. Suppose that you have to reach a certain point with a tool. So here you have a tool that you're moving, or that you're remotely moving. This is not different. And you have to go there. Now, virtual fixture, so you can design a system such that you're constrained to some motion. So you can command any motion here. But if you try to command a motion that exceed this boundary, you're forced to move along this boundary, and so on, until you converge to the final point. And you can design virtual fixture of any nature, of any geometry. And this was what was behind this idea of a steady hand. By the way, some software implementing these ideas in this project, which was based on at the Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, was performed by one of our former PhD students, Alessandro Bettini, who made this work with them. Surgical robots, again, in the case of orthopedy, large forces and accuracy. Even if the forces are not large, you may require an accuracy which is almost not available for a human surgeon. So again, robots that replace, or better said, assist the operation of surgeon, like in a brain surgery operation, or in every time you get close to the nervous system. Here it's a simulation, a rendering of an operation. And here you can also recognize in this rendering, so this is the patient, two types of robots. You see, on the left-hand side, there's a Stewart platform parallel kinematic robot, and here is a conventional serial arm. And you may have different cooperation of these two. Essentially, the parallel kinematics guarantees you a very high accuracy, but not a large enough workspace, while the serial is exactly the reverse. And in all the surgical operation, there's something that we should not forget. I mean, robots are important, but also what is around is important. In particular, the capability of having a map of the patient. So the patient is scanned with TAC or nuclear resonance, magnetic resonance devices. So we have a digital version of the patient, slice by slice, that we can reconstruct. There are techniques that plan the motion of the tool inside the body in the least invasive way, and reaching the target, removing a tumor or whatever. So all this is made offline. Then when the patient is put on the surgical table, the first thing to do is to make its registration or calibration. So have his actual position map with the images that we have of him. Otherwise, we are lost. Okay. Once this is calibrated in a sense, like the kinematic calibration that we were mentioning before, now the robot can follow the planned path, which was approved by the surgeon. The speed may be decided by the surgeon itself. Local correction due to the fact that in this path the actual tissue is too hard or too soft, or there is some extra veins that were not predicted, whatever. So all these corrections are made by the surgeon, but essentially the planning and the execution is made by the robot. Okay? And this is probably the most famous surgical robot in the world, the Da Vinci system by Intuitive Surgical. It's kind of a monopolic product. There are Da Vinci systems even here in Rome at the San Giovanni Hospital or at the Policlinico. They are more or less used, but the system is very complex, and here you can see only a partial view. It's made by three arms. Here you can see one, and there are other two here covered by material that makes the environment clean. It's a kind of a white chamber, so no dust and no pollution. There is a command station where the operator is sitting in front of it and watching the actual field of view as reported by the camera mounted at the tip of the three robot arms, and commanding motion. Okay. There is a haptic interface, sometimes haptic, sometimes not, so that you have force feedback or you don't have force feedback on the human operator. But I will stop here, because if you're interested in how this works, just take the course on medical robotics by Professor Venditelli, and you will have more information on that. Okay, so stop with medical robotics. Let's go at home. And here you see two products, two vacuum cleaners. On the left-hand side, a very, let's say, top brand product by Electrolux, which is called Trilobite, just because its surface is like a trilobite, which is, I don't know the English word for that, fossile, fossile, maybe. So very smooth, so that there are no corners that can interfere with object in the room, or tables or chairs or whatever. This is very expensive. While this is one version of iRobot Roomba, I think that this is below 300 euros right now. And let's see it in operation in another commercial video. So first of all, is this a robot? According to our definition, well, it moves on a surface, on a flat ground, but it goes left and right, it can rotate, so, I mean, more than two axes, three axes maybe. Does it have sensors? Yes, it has sensors. It has touch sensors, just when it hits something. But it has also ultrasonic sensors through which it can detect the presence of object. In the most advanced model, there is also the possibility of building its own map of the environment so that at least the things that don't move are clearly recognized, and the robot can plan its motion in the most efficient way. Another thing is that it's battery powered, so it needs to recharge, so it has to locate where its charger is when the level of the batteries goes beyond a certain threshold. It recognizes the presence of stairs. It can overcome small variation of surface height, like the presence of cables or carpets and so on. Okay, so it's a complete system. And here you can see also the way in which they operate. This is the charging station, which is approached. So there's an automatic charging by the system itself. So the idea is that you leave home in the morning, letting the system go, and when you're back, the house, I mean, the floor at least is clean. Of course, the power that this type of vacuum cleaner have is much less than a conventional one. If you buy a normal cleaner, you have 2 kilowatts of power or more. This is much less because 2 kilowatts of power would require too much batteries and too much power to sustain for more than 10 minutes or so. So it's a low power cleaning, so passing over and over the parts and using different type of system for cleaning. This is another technology, independent of robotics, but a cleaner that does not accumulate too much material, does not require too much high power, so intensity, but it has the mobility of this robot. This is the idea. And before having those products, this is an old picture that I took at one of the two main conferences in the field. IROS conference stands for International Intelligence Robots and Systems conference in 2002 in Lausanne. And at that time, there were this competition made. There was a room, a typical IKEA room with furniture, standard furniture. The competitors could bring their own mobile robots for cleaning. They have some rules, so the dimension, the size of the room, not the location of the furniture. And then they had, let's say, 10 minutes to clean the room. And there was an evaluation, a visual evaluation here. They spread at that time some sugar on the floor just to see where the robot was passing and where it did not. There were two evaluations, one on the surface cleaned and one more qualitative, like in Olympics games, of the nice strategy that the robot used or just moved randomly or whatever. So there was two kind of scoring systems. And this had a lot of great success, especially among students, and motivated also the development of commercial products. Cleaning is not only for grounds, for floors. You may have robot cleaning in a very different situation. For instance, the Skywash was, for a long time, and probably is still the largest robot existing in the world. It's used in Frankfurt for cleaning the surface of airplane in hangars. And it's a articulated arm with an end effector, which is exactly what you find in the wash station for your cars, mounted on a truck. The truck can be placed in 2, 3, maximum 4 positions around the airplane, depending on the size of the airplane. And from there on, you have, say, repetitive motion that goes around. The motion of the end effector actually is uses the CAD information of the particular plane. So when launching this system, I just have to specify if it's an Airbus 380 or if it's a Boeing of which type, and then the shape is given and also the motion is given. This is another robot prototype which is very advanced. It uses different type of system for being suspended on vertical walls. Like, I don't know if you ever seen those geckos during the summer. There is a technology which is similar to that of geckos, which eliminates vacuum between the parts. There's a cord going down because it needs water or cleaning things to be brought here and then brought back, and this can move on the surface, on the glass surface of skyscrapers. Of course, once this technology develops, there may be a cooperation with architects that design nice buildings that are energy efficient, but they are also easier to be cleaned outside by robotized system, rather than having parts to be avoided. They can just move on a flat ground. And this robot has been used also, exactly this prototype, has been used also to cleaning the ceiling of an old train station in Leipzig in Germany, which is kind of a Eiffel Tower, so it's a Belle Epoque style, so it's iron and glass, so it was very difficult to reach, and then it's not flat, okay. Still, it was capable of sustaining itself and walking in a certain way around there. And this is not cleaning, but it's similar idea of covering surfaces. Now, you don't have flat grounds, vertical or horizontal. It's outdoor. And there are systems which works with low power consumption, again. The nice thing is here that you don't have to remove dust. You have to cut grass. And if you cut grass sufficiently often, then the grass will be not high. And what you leave on the ground is useful for the grass itself. So it's what is called the biocut. So the whole idea is to change strategy, not waiting that your lawn goes too high, but having this working over and over on a daily basis or whatever, so that they don't have to, this robot doesn't have to collect the grass that is being cut. There are models which are powered by batteries, I mean conventional batteries, but the most successful one, especially in this latitude, are those which work with solar recharge. And this is one way of, again, a commercial video showing this Husqvarna type. Husqvarna produces a lot of, I mean, motorcycle, but other tools for agriculture and for the garden. And you see, it's a two-wheel differentially driven system. So there are two motors, one for each wheel. So this can turn on place or go straight or go in arc of a circle. There's a third sustaining point. And then there are cutters underneath. You can program by some interface. You can recharge it. And there is one limitation of this system. In order to avoid that this goes everywhere in your countryside, you have to put some limitation of the exploration area. So at least, I don't know if they have evolved with the system, you put an electrical wire just few centimeter, 2-3 centimeter beyond the grounds to delimit the whole area, so that the robot recognizes this and never exit that area. Inside the area, if there are trees, if there are obstacle, they are going to be avoided, but this is the area that is supposed to not to be left by the robot itself. Okay. Another problem, I thought to buy one of these. I have a small country house, My suspect is that if I leave this outside while I'm not there, somebody's going to come and and I won't find it. The answer by the marketing people said, no, but if they remove it, they won't use it because this goes together with the cable and so on. Okay. Weak motivation. Okay. So there are other practical problems, but technically this can be done. Okay, let's move to a completely different situation. What kind of robot is this? What kinematic typology? SCARA type, okay? And it's a SCARA type used to reorder sausages, Wurst. German Wurst, to put them all aligned. Why? Because they are packed more easily then, okay? And in fact, it's the mobility that we need for doing this task. Exactly this, because we have to locate one of these, go down 30 degrees of freedom, and then reorient so that we can pick it in the right way and place it in the right way. So it's exactly what is needed. Nothing more and nothing less. This is one product by, not surprising, a German company. And this is the Adept One doing the same in a more large scale, in particular using a gripper to handle more than one sausages at the time. So you see here, they're coming from production. So this gripper takes three at a time, change orientation, and place it in the right position. And there's also an algorithm, deciding where to go next and if you have to turn it. Of course, you need to know there. So there's a sensor before. This is with backlighting, so it's a camera with backlighting, which is the easiest way to have the shape of the object so that they can be located in position and orientation, and this is programmed into the robot's motion. Please, if you have any question at any time, just stop me. I'm going in automatic mode. Okay, let's change again domain. You see there are multiplicity. This is automatic refueling. There's a small joke that it's only in Italian, unfortunately. I think I've forgotten it. Com'era l'auto da sé? Ah, okay. In Italian, the self-service, for instance, the largest company, oil company in Italy, at least that has more sellers, says this is fai da te, okay? So, self-serve. So, the idea of using robots in place, somebody from Eni said, okay, this is fai da sé, so do it by itself. Okay. So this is one prototype in France of this Oscar robot, which is this object here, again mounted on a rail and holding the pump and having a jack for inserting petrol into this bus. So the idea is to automatize the refueling of gasoline. So at the end of the day, all buses come back. So there's a fleet of buses coming back to the station and having to be refueled. So they are entering into this lane. More or less, they stop close to the robot. The robot finds exactly the position where the tank is. There's an automatic injection for a, and then recharging fuel, and of course in parallel, since this is an automation system, in parallel you record which bus it is, how much fuel has been used, so you compare with the kilometers and you do all the counting that is needed. Okay, and this is for a private company, but there are also example of tanking station, one by British Petroleum. This OK is a North European company. And the idea is, I don't know if this is going to work in a large scale, but they developed a very simple kit for every car on the market. You have to replace the tank cap. There's a piping device that you can put so to help those pumps enter into the tank, and you have a transponder. You know what it is, a transponder is an electromagnetic device that characterizes uniquely the type and model of your car. You put it into your inside the car, so when you're entering this gas station, the car is recognized, so it knows that it's diesel or whatever, on which side you have your tanking cap, and then the robot moves and has prismatic joints to be placed in the right position, and then orientation for the final parts, and completely automatize the refuel. And there are other situation. This is a Shell pump in the US, and this is a different principle. Instead of the robot being placed on the ground, it's placed in a gantry type style. So it's coming from the top, and you can recognize here a prismatic joint, a second prismatic joint, the third prismatic joint, exactly the gantry type Cartesian manipulator, and then here you will most likely have three additional revolute joints in order to access the tank with the right orientation. This is another prototype developed in Germany in cooperation with two large car manufacturers. And this is intended for having refueling of conventional gasoline, but also in a maybe sometimes in the future of alternative materials like hydrogen, where you need to have full sealing. You cannot have gases going out. So this is intended in that way. And that robot, by the way, when the cars goes away, retracts itself and disappear in the ground so that you don't see anything during non-operating phases. So here, this is more presenting two systems, not a specific application. But of course, you may use robots for doing surveillance in large stores or inspection of the activity within an energy station or a central, power station. In order to do this, you need to have mobility and manipulability. So typically you have a mobile base, and here you see two types of mobile base on wheels. This is again on multiple steering wheels. There are four wheels, just to have an idea how this works. Again, we are not going to talk on this, but at this stage. So the Nomad robot base on the right has four wheels, so it is always in equilibrium, four supporting points, and each of these wheels can rotate, so you can go up and down, and simultaneously change orientation. So in practice, it's sufficient to have only two motors. This is the synchro drive. So one motor that give rolling velocity to all wheels, and one motor which change the orientation. So this is equivalent to having only one wheel that can go in this direction and can rotate in place. It's exactly, it's unicycle-like. In fact, that particular robot is not like this because it has two motors here, two motors here, two motors here, and two motors here, so that it can change the kinematics the way it likes. But this is a robot that can go everywhere. Here we have a different basis. It's a, there's a chassis, and then there are these four wheels, which are fixed in orientation. So they cannot be steered. So this goes straight, and if it has to turn, it has to skid the wheels on the ground. So there's a phase. In order to turn, you have to apply different torques on the left and right side, and the wheels are skidding on the surface. So it's a completely different story. Why it is used? Because this is most common for outdoor environment. While wheels that always perfectly roll on the ground are more suitable for indoor situation. So on top of this mobile basis, we have two manipulators. On the left, we have a 6 degrees of freedom all revolute joint Puma arm. And here we have a small scorebot arm here. This has only 5 degrees of freedom. It loses one of the joint axes of the wrist. Okay, but and it's mounted also in a different way. So this is on top. This is on the side, on the front actually, together with a laser scanner. So both systems are intended to move around, look for something, and when they find themselves in front of something, do some manual operation, like rotating some valves or checking some electrical device and so on. This is another situation, more complex. This is again at LAS in Toulouse. You see here wheeled vehicle, although only this and the equivalent wheel on the other side are actuated. These are only supported wheels. Here is a manipulator mounted on top with a camera on the end effector, a laser sink, and a whole batteries of ultrasonic sensors. We will describe this later on. So these are all proximity sensor for measuring distances to objects in the environment. In addition, this carries also a trailer, a single trailer hooked at the back. And here you can see a map of this laboratory with the Hylar 2bis robot with its trailer. So this is a tractor trailer system. And you can imagine that moving this around without colliding with walls or object, it's even more difficult than moving around an articulated manipulator. Why? Because this belongs to the class where we cannot actuate things in all directions, locally. If this was on a free place, by suitable maneuvering, we can bring the system from one initial configuration like this to any other final configuration. But the things get, and it's already quite difficult. I don't know if you have ever had a, or driven a caravan, and to park, it's not easy, even if you have a lot of space. In addition, with this presence of obstacles that you need to avoid, the motion planning problem becomes very hard. Okay, and needs special techniques that, again, you will see in the course by Professor Oriolo. Inspection and surveillance. The simulation in this case can be used to check if you can access to object. Okay, I repeat the question. So given this, so forget about the manipulator now. Given this set of sensors, so the ultrasonic sensor all around and the laser seek in front, the laser seek has more or less more than 180 degrees of view, okay? And both of them at different distance are able to detect if in a certain direction, so the laser seek at the same time by a one laser scan returns for each angle a distance to the most closest object in that direction. The ultrasonic sensor do something similar, only not at the distance that is covered by the laser, so more close, and with some uncertainty because each sensor has a cone of view and so sends ultrasonic frequency and returns, so it's a transmitter detector, and then computes the time of flight at that frequency and has an estimate of the distance to the object in that direction with some uncertainty because it collects some other reflexes. And this is done for all of them. So at some point, you turn off the system and he sees something around and then starts moving and again does another acquisition and should fuse this acquisition with what was before, given the fact that it has some displacement. So it has to merge several data in a noisy data in the most efficient way. And there are many techniques, including extended Kalman filtering or particle filtering and methods like this that are able to incrementally construct the environment. Okay. Now, maybe your question was simpler in the sense, how could he know that this is done like this? This is just a map. So this is a given map. Then if we turn on the system there, he will first recognize something like this, and then while exploring, because you have to also give some strategy for exploring things. How will you know that you have seen everything which is in this room? If I start and it's like being blind and going around and touching things. At some point you may decide, if your argument is complete, that you have touched everything and that you have an image of the environment, okay? The fact that you can use both type of sensor, yes. The laser seek is much more expensive and much more accurate, I should say. You could use also only the laser seek, but the laser seek is super. The original HiLAR had only ultrasonic sensor. Then on top of that, they have placed the laser seek. Okay, but of course you can fuse this information from different sensors and acquired in different position. Okay, so this is the main idea of what is called simultaneous localization and mapping. We will come back to this in a few moments. Okay, so here it is. This is a vehicle, different mobility, actually fixed wheels, front wheels, fixed back wheels, but the vehicle can change internal configuration around a central axis. So that if you straight this out, it goes straight, and if you rotate, it rotates, and if you rotate it even closer, it rotates with a smaller radius of curvature, so it can really make rotation almost on itself. Okay, and this vehicle is quite rugged and is intended for exploring abandoned mines. This is in Australia. Okay, although Groundhog was developed by Carnegie Mellon. Again, it has some sensing. It has some sensor to detect gases in the mines. This is, or the presence of water in some branch of the mine. And it uses this type of algorithm that acquires all information and without knowing having a map, because there are two problems. I have the map and I have to understand where I am in the map. This is the localization problem. But if I don't have the map, I have to move myself, explore, define locally a map, and simultaneously understanding where in this locally defined map I am, and probably after making a long round, recognizing that I've done a whole loop, and I'm again in a situation that I have discovered before. And this is exactly what happened if you go through the many chambers and corridors that constitute a typical coal mine. Okay? Okay, this is another important thing, and I should not forget to mention this, especially because of my good friend and colleague, Professor Nardi, who's very much involved in RoboCup activities, and also Fiora Pirri with the RoboRescue competition. So these are two competitions, robotic competition, that develop over the years in order to understand some basic issue of autonomy and accessibility. So RoboCup is playing soccer with robots with different type of leagues, originally only wheeled mobile robots, now also legged leagues with used to be Sony Aibo four-legged dogs, robotic dogs. Now they are now humanoid. And they play soccer. The final intention is in 2050 to have a robot team playing, not beating, maybe beating a human team of soccer players. I don't know if they're going to make it. But there are a lot of progresses. In doing so, you explore a lot of scientific and technical challenges related to autonomy, to group cooperation of autonomous agents, to sensing, coordination, strategies, reasoning to obtain some goal, and so on and so on. Goal in the strict sense in this case. In the RoboRescue competition, the competition is to have an intervention in a situation after an earthquake or some tsunami damage, as was really the case in the near Sendai in Japan, in the power nuclear power plant, and be able to explore a very difficult environment, locating for victims, for instance, or for sources of radioactivity. Okay, so this is why in this competition you can design your own robot. This was the winner some years ago in 2003 in Padova. Capable of going up the stairs without having fancy kinematics of legs, just wheels powered enough to go up the ramp and then also go on flat ground. Okay, so here the emphasis is on mobility in difficult condition and also using sensors to locate human victims or critical aspects. So this is search and rescue activities of robots, organized in competition, but with many practical application and also scientific advances. More than that, I cannot say. So, talking about challenges, there are public institutions. This is DARPA, so it's the American Department for Energy and Protection. That develop some challenges for technologists and roboticists. This was the first DARPA grant challenge, namely having an autonomous vehicle drive about 200 miles in different conditions, desert, highway, and other type of streets, and getting to the end safely. Okay. And there were also different vehicles, so typically cars or trucks, even much larger, but also motorbikes, which is surprising for me. Okay. Much more challenging, because here the dynamics of equilibrium is more critical. Okay. So the first few editions were a mess. No single competitor were able to complete the challenge. So there was no ranking at all, even, until in 2005, finally, I mean, with the experience and collecting the information, there were many teams that succeeded, and this was the winner, Stanley team. They were using a normal Volkswagen Touareg, equipped, I mean, of course, with changes in the driving system so that it could speed and turn the wheel autonomously, but most of it has a battery of laser scanner, and not only, also other things in order to help mapping, localizing, and understanding the situation of the terrain, so to correct the driving. Here, instead, is one team or motorcycle, and I would say that you can look at the video interview of Sebastian Troon, which was, now it's a very world star of robotics, especially for this reason. He moved later on from Stanford, actually still a Stanford professor, but is working now for Google and contributing to autonomy of the Google car, based on this idea. So you can look at the interview on the video that you have available on the website. But let's look at the video about the motorcycle, probably because I used to be a motorcycle driver, so I like this more. Okay? This is it. Okay. So this is, you will listen to the words, but it's not important now. The idea of Lewandowski was, of course, a motorcycle needs more accurate control, because independently of where you want to go, you have to stay balanced. Okay, so you have seen that it's launching the motorcycle requires some initial balance, but from there on, by suitably combining the steering and the acceleration, you can stay in balance and reorient in any direction. There are multiple sensor here. There are cameras. There are sensor on board for steering. Of course, things may also not work always properly like this. So this may fall, and then there's not yet a strategy for resuming from the ground. There are two cameras in front, and you need real-time processing of this, very critical for a motorcycle, because small changes in the ground could affect the stability. You need to have a prompt reaction, so you have an accelerometer mounted on board, you have a GPS system for localization, and altogether you have the capability of turning quite rapidly the steering of the front wheel. I think that you will see also some cases where things go wrong. Again, launching the system, and now, okay, so in this case, not being capable of avoiding this. But I think that this was really an achievement at that time. Again, starting and keeping equilibrium. And then stopping. Okay, not bad. Okay, so we are almost done with this. Use of robots for entertainment and free time. Having it as a bartender, I don't know if this is very nice or not. You may prefer a human being. This was another challenge made by the American Artificial Intelligence Association. So this robot needs to clean the court from a tennis ball as fast as possible, so localizing them and having a strategy for getting to all tennis ball as fast as possible. And this is another video which I found on the net, talking about bartenders. This is a robot that fills in a glass of beer. Okay. Now, it's a conventional industrial robot with a gripper. Here is the full bottle. Here is the glass. And if you haven't seen this video before, I can challenge you to understand how the robot will do this filling of the glass. Some suggestion? So first, it needs to take the bottle. And then? Can I? This is empty. So the bottle is without the top. So the robot will take the bottle, go over the glass, rotate it carefully, then fill it. Okay, and that's it. So this is what I was thinking of when I started looking at the video. And now we will see what happens. As you can see, it's a conventional robot, so it approaches. It takes the glass and puts it on this special device. Apparently, nothing changed. Now it takes the bottle, goes over, and now it does something that only an expert beer drinker would do. So come from the bottom, okay, and it goes over with some white shaum, and this is very nice. The final part requires some extra motion. You see, this is a okay, this motion, remember this motion. This is a motion with zero velocity and only angular velocity. So I'm not moving this point, but I'm only, okay. So that's it. So from each of these, please, I invite you to explore. There are many, many videos, so this is just a sample. But for each of them, try to understand the mobility that it's behind and what you need in terms of kinematics, sensors, and whatever. If you happen to find yourself in Berlin, go to this museum for communication, where you can still find those 50 years like design on purpose in a kind of vintage way that helps you guiding you through the museum, which is they have some interface, they are connected to internet, so when you get closer to whatever piece of art, you can ask where you can find something similar, like in your app on smartphones. Exactly in the same way, this came before. But there's motion and mobility here. So this museum guidance should bring visitors around and decide which part of the museum is more full than others, so change the order of visit, avoid dynamic obstacles. So there is all the part connected to physical motion in the real world, which is important and makes this a real robotics problem and not a computer science problem alone. Finally, entertainment. A lot of robot has been used by Hollywood in different movies. For instance, this in I don't know if you ever seen this movie on Anaconda. This was a snake, and in fact, it was a robotic snake with 60 degrees of freedom, 12 meter long, and hydraulic actuation, all masked into a snake-like surface. Okay. And if you want to replicate motion, human motion, you may have this kind of exoskeleton, and then a humanoid structure here. And here is the master. Now, the master is not just moving things and replicating. He's moving himself with this kind of exoskeleton so that the robot is replicating and doing the same motion. Okay. Now, it seems, apart from technological development, it seems rather simple here. But remember that if you keep equilibrium, so you're not doing strange motion and falling down, this does not mean that the robot itself can keep equilibrium, even if it's reproducing exactly your own movement. Why is that? First of all, the robot has not the same mass distribution as the master. Okay, so the center of mass may be placed differently. So while I'm keeping still equilibrium, like this, in the same configuration, the robot may have its center of mass out of the supporting feet and fall down. So when you have mobile base, you need to take into account much more constraint and sensing capability. Typically, the robot, and not only this human replication, but also the humanoid robots that, like Nao or Asimo and so on, they have under the feet force sensing through which they are capable of locating not only the center of pressure, but also some dynamic special point connected to dynamic locomotion. And through this, corrects the internal configuration so to keep equilibrium not only in static situation but also while walking. Okay? So, we are getting closer to human-robot interaction. Human-robot interaction, this old picture shows the same robot as before by Sarkos, shaking hands with a human, talking with him. And as we said, there are, in this picture, two types of interaction between the robot and the human. One is physical, touching, exchanging forces at the contact, and one is cognitive. So the robot is speaking to the human, so speech synthesis, but also recognizing what the human is saying, so speech recognition, and then elaborating an answer. So you see, there's a cognitive part and there's a physical part, and these are not really separated. Somebody says that a brain without a body would never learn to live in a real world because the experience is acquired through the body and then processed in the brain. Okay, so this means that cognitive and physical aspects are really intertwined. Although in research you typically find people working only on one side or the other of the problem. And to give you just a simple illustration of the two aspects of cognitive or physical human-robot interaction, the acronym are HRI with a small or C or small p, depending on this. These are results taken from two European projects, now both over since a few years. On the left, you have a typical cognitive interaction. I'm not saying that this is the state of the art at all, but just to have a feeling of what happens. In this case, you should carefully listen also to the voices. And if you don't hear it, I will repeat it for you. So this is the robots at CWE. Okay. So the robot says, do you want me to learn how to close this box? Start the demonstration. Show me how I should do this. And the human is putting the open box in front of the robot.
It's very obvious, don't you think?
The robot speaks, no, makes small talk with the human. It's hot. So show me how to do this task.
And probably so that I can reach it.
So place it so that I can reach it and grasp it. So the human takes the hand and says start and moves the arm in the way so the robot puts himself into a passive compliance situation and then moves so to close the box. A very simple. So the robot asks, are you happy with this demonstration? So should I learn again or this is okay so that I can replay this for you? So start again, says the human. The robot looks at the hand that is going to move, and this is only for letting the human understand that what is going to do next. And this motion is processed from the original motion. It's not exactly reproducing the same motion, but extracting some elementary representation of this motion and executing this. Otherwise, for any specific motion that it should learn, it should have a whole bunch of small motion which are not really relevant. So there's a motion capture which tries to condense this information in few elementary motion. While here on the right-hand side, there's no interaction at all, no communication. Here I'm standing in front of the DLR lightweight robot. This was 2005. The robot is moving. It's doing some tasks. It's moving from where it is. It starts and goes toward me. And I'm intercepting its motion. And there is no sensor outside. There's no visual camera. There's no force sensing. There's no tactile device, no proximity sensor, nothing at all. But the robot is able to recognize that there is a collision and stop its motion and puts himself into a floating mode so that I can continue to pushing it around the workspace. So this is purely physical interaction. And I can touch it in different points, and the robot is floating away under my pressure. Okay, compensating for gravity, and working like floating in space under this physical contact. Okay, the physical contact is not sensed directly. There's a method that we developed to understand that something is happening and you recognize this as a contact, external contact, and you can also localize this contact on the specific links. You cannot say exactly where on the link, but if you know that some force estimation is acting on some prescribed link, then you can react properly as a robot. Okay, this is the result of this friend's project. So the contact that you have seen up to now, in the second case, they should be avoided. So this is just detecting an accidental collision. In the previous case, there is contact, but just in the learning phase. Then the robot is doing this elementary task by itself. But there are other situations where the contact is intentionally achieved in order to do some collaborative task. Human robot, I should change the title. I should say human robot collaboration. This is the right term. Cooperation is usually between robots. Collaboration is between human and robot, but okay, the concept is the same. And here are there are two examples. This is a robot, very massive, I would say. So it's humanoid in its upper part, but it's moving on wheels, which are covered under the base platform, holding a table together with a human and cooperating or collaborating in transport of this object. When we do something together like this, we, with another human, so human-human cooperation or collaboration. or two robots together holding a heavy part, or a robot and a human, beyond common motion, which is not typically not exactly the same, modulo the displacement between the two grasping points, what we really are doing in this case is exchanging force information through the common object. Okay, when we have to carry, can I take it, this again? When I have to carry this, suppose this bottle is very heavy, but it's also fragile. So one arm is pulling, the other is pushing, or they should move exactly in the same way. This is never possible. So if I'm compressing too much things, maybe it's like this, I would crash the object, okay? Sorry about that. So it's very important for small deviation, especially when you're holding firmly a relatively delicate object, that you control the exchanged forces. It's not only motion involved in such tasks, okay? Both when we are doing this task together with another human, or when we are doing this task with a robot, or when two robots are doing the same. So this is very critical, and it's physical cooperation. And this is an industrial application of the same concept, where a robot is holding a heavy part, and the operator is only moving this part in time. This is very similar to what we have mentioned before, the virtual fixture idea. For instance, for inserting a door into the car body, the actual sequence of motion, so change of position and orientation, is very complex. If the human had to sustain the weight of the car, of the door, and doing this fine motion, it would be very difficult to perform this. So this cobot, which means collaborative robot, is constraining the motion in the right direction that will achieve assembly, but the timing along this constrained motion is given by the human operation. So I decide to go faster or slower and do the insertion. Okay, so this is the concept. Again, it's a cooperation with constrained direction of motion. Exactly the same as in the virtual fixture case with the medical robotic application. Okay. Robot hands, we are getting closer to anthropomorphic design. This has been one of has been over the decades, I would say, the last 30 years or so, a lot of research about robotics hands, wishing to replicate the human power and dexterity, and capability of sensing and moving things in different ways. Now, it is obvious that the biological inspiration is very strong in this case. Although, if you have to do some elementary task, especially in the industrial environment, one may wonder, but should I have an end effector which is as complex as a human hand for doing very simple tasks? The answer is clearly no. In fact, most industrial hands are grippers that close and open, or are very sophisticated objects that can grasp things of various shape and size, but they are devoted only to that task. They are not as flexible as the human hand. And this is okay for many situations. On the other hand, we would like to replicate as close as possible the human hand for a number of reasons. And these are two examples of a series of robot hands developed by the University of Bologna, a very strong center in this field. So the UB hand, and here you see one with soft coverage on the three fingers, and here is the same hand where the fingers have been naked. So you can recognize here some tactile sensing placed at every phalanx of the three fingers, okay? So that you can touch things not only with the tip, but also with the internal part of the finger. It's like a whole hand manipulation. So you're not just taking things like that and sensing that you're pressing on this pen, you can take things like that, or you would like to do manipulation like that. In fact, in the scientific description of grasping, of human hand mobility, you recognize a different type of grasp that goes from the so-called power grasp, when you're holding things firmly. And when you have a power grasp, you can resist to disturbing forces that tend to let the object go out of your grasp. Okay, but you cannot reconfigure this. I mean, you can change the whole position of the arm. There is the other extreme is the high manipulability grasp. For instance, when I'm holding an object like this, and I can make let him change orientation very fast and in any direction, but it's very simple to or it's very difficult to resist to disturbing forces. And there is a whole bunch of intermediate situation. Okay, so the idea here at that time, sorry, this is yours. The idea here was to have sensing as close as possible, similar to the human touch sensing, and with the same mobility, so that the same hand can do different type of grasping, so power grasp or dexterous manipulation. This is why those type of sensor. This robot, this hand had three fingers plus the palm, which is very important, so that you can grasp things and pushing them against the palm in order to hold it. Moreover, the you can see here some pulleys and strings, because the mobility of this joints in this structure is given by motors which are placed beyond the hand and transfer their motion through this cables. So it's a cable-driven structure, so that the hand itself is very light, but all the heavy parts, the motors, are placed beyond. And in fact, the first hand, even with five fingers or four fingers, if you look at the end, it's human-like size. But then there was kind of a box like this with all the motors, with all the electronics. So it was not carryable, like not even mountable as an effector of an industrial robot. Okay. So this is one of the latest version of the UB hand, one which is again very light, and it's also low cost because it's made with components that can be printed with rapid prototyping devices. Okay, so with 3D printers. And in addition, there are hinges that replace the degrees of freedom, so that the hand itself is deformable and compliant, so that it adapts itself automatically in a passive way to the shape of the object that is grasping. And here we will see an example where the motion is commanded not by specifying the motion of the single motors, but just replicating the motion of a human hand. So there's a person wearing this data glove. This data glove is a sensorized glove, so that you can measure the angle that each joint is doing. So it's measuring this and in real time commanding. It's like telemanipulation in a generalized sense. And here is the way in which this moves. There are some disturbance, you see, but you should imagine that this is a very light and soft hand, something which is completely different from the previous ideas, where you have articulated but essentially rigid links. And of course, it can grasp whatever object by adapting, complying around the object itself. And if you give more power to the motors, this grasp becomes a power grasp because you're applying more forces. So, so this idea has been further developed, and I should mention, if I didn't have the time to put this in, but there's a work by Professor Bicchi at the University of Pisa in cooperation with IIT, the Italian Institute of Technology in Genova, on a so-called soft hand, which has, it's exactly like this, but it has only one motor or two motors, instead of having one motor for each degrees of freedom like in the previous case. So each finger had 3 degrees of freedom, so 9 degrees of freedom, 9 motors. Okay? So with less, so you see that it can hold things in different position. So with less actuation, but with a smart realization of motion, you can reproduce a large majority, like 90% of the typical grasp of a human hand. So if you relax the desire of reproducing all mobility of the human hand, but you focus only on the main activities, you can reduce, eliminate actuation and obtain the same result. And this is a very impressive situation. And by the way, you can help yourself with the environment in order to perform differently. So you can take an object and reconfigure it by helping yourself with the constraints given by the environment, like you would do in reality. Here I have another video. This is the iCub. This is another product by the Italian Institute of Technology. It's an open source project. So iCub is a small robot, 3.5-year-old, that should behave like a human being. So crabble, like on its hands and knees. And it has this new hand, which is kind of similar. Again, let's see at the mobility of this dexterous hand. And you will see now how, where the motor are placed. So to see that this is still not. So these are all the motors. You see, when one of these joints is moving, you will see the associated. So this is compact, but still it requires some extra space. So again, this is not the latest state of the art. So this is good, but you may achieve similar performance without that many motors, but only with few motors, okay? This is called exploiting the synergies, synergies of the human hand, and replicating it into a mechanical robotic hand. So we talk about the size of these motors and the whole system. In 1992, in the World Exposition of Seville, the UB second hand, which is this one, was shown in operation, not only by itself, but all the electronics and the motors were put into a single link. Here are the motors. Here is the electronics which commands the motor and processes the sensing device on the fingers. And the whole thing could be mounted, replacing the forearm of a Unimation Puma industrial robot. So this could be really integrated in the industrial robot without the need of extra box or space for the actuation. So this was kind of a nice result at that time. And as I said, this is exactly a picture from Antonio Bicchi from the University of Pisa. Before starting to develop this soft hand, he proposed this minimalistic solution to manipulability. So instead of having many degrees of freedom like the human hand and being bio-inspired by the nature as a single solution, he proposed some minimalistic design. And here is there's a robot which is able to manipulate an object with only two motors. And this is how it works. Suppose that there's a plate here and there's an object between the two plates. And with the upper plate, you can have two motion, left and right, or front and back. Now, by combining this motion, you let the object roll on the surface, and by a suitable sequence of commands, like in the parking maneuver of a car, you may bring this object from one point to another point, changing its orientation and changing the contact point, so commanding with two motors 5 degrees of freedom in an arbitrary way. So suppose that the object is a sphere, okay? Suppose that is the Earth. So I want to go from one position x, y, with the South Pole touching the ground and Rome placed in your direction, to another x, y position with New York touching the ground and Rome pointing in that direction. So I'm specifying 5 quantities. The contact point, x, y, the place on the surface of the Earth that should be at the contact point, other 2 variables, and then 1 angle. So I'm specifying a task that reconfigures this Earth from one situation to another, changing its 5 variables. And I can do this by maneuvering only 2 commands, left and right, up and down. And this Earth will roll appropriately and end up in the right configuration. So this is an underactuated system, like those that we have seen before, that manipulates object and reconfigures the object as desired. It requires much more intelligence, but it's minimalistic in terms of sensing and actuation capability. Okay? So it costs less. This is the idea. So this is one trend of research, and the same spirit was the one that was able to use synergy in order to reproduce 90% of the human grasp with a simple robotic hand. We're getting closer to biomorphism, so not only human hand, but also type of animals. There's a very important laboratory at MIT, the so-called MIT Leg Laboratory, where they develop a lot of type of animals and locomotion for them. This is a flamingo type. This is a dinosaur that can jump and sustain equilibrium during flight by changing the position of the tail, like dinosaur used to do. Again, these are, I don't know if you ever seen this Sony Aibo. Have you ever seen this in operation? This is unfortunate because Sony decided to go out of the robotics field after having produced this type of product and also many humanoids, small humanoids. Sony Aibo was a success like the iPhone. So when they put it on they sold it for 2,000 euros, through the web. In the first day, they sell 5,000 of this object. So not the same amount of iPhones, but it was really a big success because you could use this for entertainment. They had some learning process. These dogs can recognize the voice of the owner and can recognize if you touch them or if you hit them, and then the next time that he hears his voice, if you have hit the dog the last time, it will retract. So it's not just a toy, it's something that changed behavior in motion, I mean, over time. It had the mobility, it was capable, for instance, after falling, of understanding through an accelerometer which is the direction of the gravity field and sequencing the motion of his four legs in order to stand up again in an autonomous way. It was very impressive, and it was used actually for the RoboCup soccer legged league for a few years, until Sony decided that this was like a demonstration of technological advance, but they were not really involved in, I mean, they wanted to do consumer electronics, but not consumer robotics in a sense. Okay, so they went out of the market and this died. So it's, if you find some video, you will certainly find some video on the internet, look at the behavior of these dogs and you will be impressed as we were at that time. By the way, all these degrees of freedom and actuated and sensed joints, camera and whatever, were packed in a 1.6 kilogram stuff, including a programming, how do you say, una scheda, a board that you can put in and let the robot really work without any communication with the external, not Ethernet, no wireless, nothing else. Okay, so it was fully autonomous. Well, we went very long, so I prefer to stop here rather than rush in the few last slides. So on Monday, we will complete this part, and then finally move to a completely different area, namely starting describing the kinematics of object and of manipulators. We will do in parallel, so in the following lecture, after having done these large surveys of application, we will progress in parallel describing components, so actuators, sensors, architectures, and mathematical description of the behavior. Okay, so we will progress in the next weeks in parallel, not following the exact order of the slide that you have in the website. And I will try, using the email that I have, to announce you in advance what we are going to do next lecture, week by week. Okay?